robots are getting insane. And they promise to transform industries and even entire economies. And thanks to AI, they're accelerating faster than ever. But this one, it can't even walk. Yet these guys keep making them. Because it's actually tackling a problem that none of these other machines really solved. And it's actually changing people's lives without AI. I spent the last couple of weeks in Tokyo to try to understand how they're actually doing this. So I want to tell you the story behind this and the story of the founder. Because I really think it can change the way that we look at robots and how we experience this strange new world. So my personal curiosity with robots first started a couple years ago when a humanoid robot accurately guessed my age. And there was something kind of creepy about this experience. I know it's not a human, but it could see, it could reason based on what it saw, and it kind of moves and looks like a human. And maybe I just watched too much sci-fi, but this could come from a real rational fear of being replaced. According to the study from the World Economic Forum that literally came out last week, AI and robotics will create 170 million new roles by 2030, but it will also displace 92 million jobs. And transitioning all these people to these new types of jobs, it's not really going to be that easy because they require completely different skill sets. So what happens when we start to get more of these robots that can not only do the manual labor, but also see you and reason and talk to you like a person?
Hi, can I ask you some questions?
Oh, okay.
Okay. Are you a social person?
Very shy.
Ah, shy. Okay.
Yeah. This is Chifuyu, and she is not an AI. She was a stage sound operator for 15 years until at the age of 35, she was suddenly diagnosed with a disease called chronic fatigue syndrome.
It makes me exhausted when I walk about 10 meters.
So instead, she uses these avatar robots to work at this cafe in Tokyo, where instead of replacing humans, it creates jobs for a group of people who are typically left behind.
I have a camera on my forehead, so I can see you very well. I'm operating this robot using a laptop PC at home. Uh-huh. Yeah, and I can move my head and hands with a single click.
One last question. Can you tell me one of the weirdest people you met?
It's a very difficult question.
In Japanese, these robots are called bunshin, which translates into dividing the body. The ninja art of bunshin no jutsu means clone technique, where you divide the body into multiple copies and control them. And here at Dawn Cafe, there's three different types of bunshins, piloted by people who've lost function of their bodies as paid employees at this cafe. This is Naoki. He has severe heart failure and he's waiting for a heart transplant. And it's a condition that doesn't allow him to work a normal job. There were some awkward moments during this interaction.
I'm not an infinite robot, okay?
Sorry.
It's a robot joke.
What did you do before Orihime operator?
Yeah, office worker.
Where are you from?
Yeah, Tokyo Shinjuku.
But bunshin also means alter ego.
Last time you said you were the Japanese Tom Cruise.
I'm more handsome than Tom Cruise. Let's go. I take out the kettle with my right hand and I will pour the coffee with my left hand. I will turn back to the front. Okay, hello again. Two, three. Okay, applause. Thank you. Oh, please give me more applause. Come on. Kettle is warm.
Smells very good. Arigatou gozaimasu. It's very good.
Yeah.
And that's how a pilot makes coffee. This barista robot is from Kawada Robotics. This is Kawada-san, and his company actually specializes in industrial robots, but somehow they got involved in the cafe.
I believe we met in 2019 at this event called the Lives Tokyo. Then Ori-san said, there's this one lady who used to be a barista. One day when she was training, her arms didn't work. Then she was diagnosed with ALS. So she lost a job and she's staying home in Nagoya, which is 300 kilos away from here. Ori-san wanted her to be barista again. Engineers are here and she's over there. They never ever met. But she would tell how to move the hot water, how slowly to press it down, what would be nice movement for the robot to be serving the coffee. And without meeting at all, they created the Telebarista.
Since coming here to Japan, I've decided to completely change the direction of the video because I found this to be a much more interesting story. And this seamless collaboration with my team would not have been possible without Milanote, who is also the sponsor of today's video. We use Milanote to organize all of our research from the early brainstorming phase all the way to the scene breakdowns. Just having a visual board clarifies everything, and we can start to make connections that we didn't see before. When we're working remotely, being able to share and edit boards in real time during our meetings makes our collaboration very seamless. It's kind of replaced PDFs for us. It's completely free with no time limit, so you can sign up using the link in the description. What I found interesting is that this robot was using human tools. And that's because the Kawada robots are actually designed specifically for an economy like Japan, which is full of small companies who's not quite big enough to buy assembly robots to perform one specific task. Because they need someone who can do a variety of things, like painting or packaging. So humans are naturally the best for this kind of job, because we have these amazing things called hands. But Japan also has a shrinking labor force. So these robots are designed to work side by side with humans. It can change hands and it can reconfigure itself for a variety of tasks. But despite being human size, Kawada-san had a very strong opinion on what the robots should look like.
These robots, they look like robots. They don't look, or I don't think they're trying to resemble anything like a human. Is that an intentional design choice, or is it more like economical to design like this?
Robot is a tool. So tools should look like a tool. But for industrial robot, it should say what it cannot do. I mean, the robot is not very smart. That's why the head is so small. I have two arms, so it's predictable how it moves. Uh-huh. Yes, to answer your question, the appearance is very intentional. Problem with the human-shaped robot is people expect it to be able to do everything, but it really can't. If it resembles too much like a human, people feel it's creepy.
He's talking about the uncanny valley effect, which was coined in the 1970s by the roboticist Masahiro Mori, describing the sensation of discomfort that we feel when confronted with human-like entity. And this graph describes it pretty well. As an artificial being gets closer to human-likeness, there's a certain point, just at the point of being almost human, that makes us feel extremely uncomfortable. In that sense, the Orihimes are really well-designed. The Orihimes can also be controlled by simply pressing a button or moving it around on your iPad. This is what the pilot can see. And with a simple click, the Orihimes can create gestures and expressions. Some of these people have never had movement in their necks or hands. So for a lot of people, this is the first time that they're able to express their emotions like this. But before getting into the robots, I want to tell you a little bit about the person behind this.
そうなってしまっていること自体がすごく申し訳なくって、自分なんかいなくてはならない、いない方がいいのにと思ってしまうこと自体がとても辛かったですね。
This is Ori Yoshifuji, the roboticist behind the Orihimes. He was ill between elementary through middle school, and he was bedridden for about 3.5 years. And during this time, he experienced extreme isolation. So he decided to go into robotics with the core goal of eliminating loneliness.
You're limiting certain things from the design. Was that a part of the design process when you were designing the robots?
私はいくつか、方法を考えたときに、人形劇、人形劇、あるいは、人形浄瑠璃というものが、まあ、日本のね、能の世界であって、人形浄瑠璃であったりとか、能ですね。
No masks are neutral by design, and they rely entirely on the performer to bring them to life. These three completely different expressions, yeah, they're all from the same mask, just viewed from different angles. So a slight tilt of the head, or a change in posture, or the way the light hits the mask can completely transform the expression. The orihime work in a very similar way. Instead of showing pre-programmed emotions on a face screen,They depend on the pilot's ability to project their feelings through movement. It's not just about pushing buttons. The pilot actually has to align their intent with every pose that they choose. But before even getting into these robots, Ori actually tried a couple different experiments. The first thing he designed was a wheelchair.
人工車椅子を作っていたんですが、車椅子があっても移動ができない人たちにたくさん出会ったことで、やはり車椅子でも参加できない移動困難な人たちが社会に参加できる方法を研究することにしました。
Ori just told me that he realized even high-tech wheelchairs couldn't help people in society. Seems pretty obvious, but I had to move my Airbnb and I realized there's no elevators. The built environment in Japan is just not designed for accessibility, and I really think that even the most high-tech wheelchair is not going to help.
Hi. As you can see, these robots take up quite a lot of space and they move along this black line. And, you know, if I was a business, I would want to try to cluster the space as much as possible and pack in as many tables.
But by creating space for the orihimes to move around, the space actually becomes accessible.In architecture, we actually have a name for this.
See, curb cuts were originally put in place for wheelchair users, but actually it ended up helping other groups of people, like people pushing strollers or cyclists. So we call this the curb cut effect. Features designed for specific groups often end up helping a broader population. But it wasn't until he met this online stranger that he started actively developing these robots.
もう今から10年以上前なんですが、寝たきりの、男からメールが来ました。彼は顎を使ってパソコンを使っていたんですよね。人生を想像することができなかったし、私はたった3年半で孤独で苦しんでいたわけですが、20年寝たきりの人が社会に戻れるんだろうか、どうやって参加するんだろうか。
He's talking aboutBenda, who was in an accident when he was 4 years old, and he was paralyzed from neck down. So he hired Benda to be his first pilot to test out the first iteration of the Orihimes.
And how did you feel when you saw him first time using the Orihime?
彼は寝たきりなので首を動かしたこともないし、腕を動かしたこともないんですよね。相槌というものを彼は知りませんでした。
Aizuchi
is this thing that Japanese people do that's like, it's a way of communicating to the other person that you're paying attention. But a lot of it is kind of relying on body language as well. And according to Ori, this helped Benda join the circle of people. So using the Orihimes, Benda could finally communicate and go different places. But there was a key piece that was missing. He didn't have a reason to be at a certain place.And without this purpose, he never felt like he belonged anywhere. And that's where the cafe comes in. At the cafe, they work, they serve people, and they have a routine, and they have a role. The architecture, in this case, is the glue that ties everything together.
いわば、オリヒメというのはヘッドマウントディスプレイの逆で VR 世界からリアル世界に行くためのツールと言えるかもしれません。大事なことは選択肢があることだと思ってます。選択肢がないから人は孤独になってしまったり、自分の望まない人生を歩むことになってしまう。
So, in the end, it's about choice. Having a choice is what puts everyone on an equal plane. There was one thing that I noticed while I was there. This was when the cafe was about to close.
手伝ってるから、ミカちゃん前を向くと、
The Orihimes were chatting amongst themselves. There are things in the physical space that the planned world of the virtual space doesn't provide. You can make little chit-chats and you can make conversation. And it's these in-between moments that actually create this human connection. In fact, that's how I came across this cafe. And that's also how Ori and Kawada met each other, because their booth just happened to be next to each other in this conference.
Origami wa ne, sugoku kou, teinei ni, kirei ni oranaku te naranai toyukoto yoku iwareteta desu kedo, watashi wa souyu no ga amari suki janakatta desu yo. こういう折り方があってもいいんじゃないかということで創作折り紙を10歳ぐらいから始めました、ね、しかしその時に創作折り紙をやっていたことが将来のものづくりにつながりましたね。なので折り紙は私の原点です。だからオリと名乗ってます。
The world is not perfect. You know, life is messy. And I think these robotic inventions, rather than helping us be more perfect or more efficient, highlights the beauty and the spaces in between.
My name is Koki. I'm serving this table today. I'm operating this robot from my home 360 kilometers away from the cafe in Nihonbashi, Tokyo.
後ろに来ましたよ。
岡山県の方もすごく暑くて、もうなんか、そうなんです。
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
ありがとうございます。バイバイ。
バイ。
バイ。